people that I've worked with and gotten to know over the years. In fact, over half a century now. Or most of you are too young, much younger than Star Trek. But I can tell who the original fans are when you're around. I see you. Your gray hair. Your no hair. Well, thank you. We bless your heart for having been the original fans that gave us this incredible 50-year journey. This year, 2016, in September, Star Trek will be 50 years old. The credit belongs to those original fans here. But the wonderful thing about those original fans is they multiply like triples. You're the sons and daughters and grandchildren and nieces and nephews of the original fans. And so we not only have the next generation, but third and fourth generation Star Trek fans. So thank you all very much. This is an absolutely unimagined gift. But to be frank, last week I was very apprehensive about coming to Texas. You know what the news has been saying about you. And last Thursday, they said that, I was in New York then, they said that Dallas is going to have a thunderstorm. We've been seeing all the storming that's been going on in the Houston area. It's really horrible what's happening there. In fact, Thursday morning they announced that five soldiers had died in the flooding there. They'd been swept away. So, give our thoughts to their families that suffered that horrible loss. But with Dallas, when we arrived, the tarmac was bone dry. The sky was gray, but there was no evidence of rain. And then we saw, as we were driving in, some sprinkles on the windshield. But that was about it. And this morning was beautiful. Blue skies and puffy white cotton clouds. So this has been a wonderful visit. And as we begin this portion of it, it's wonderful to see this room filled with you guys, because when they said I'm going on at 4:30, I thought everybody's going to be gone. You know, the convention's winding down. But I guess I didn't know Texas Star Trek fans. You are dedicated, determined, and so impatient. Here you are. And that's what's given us this 50-year journey. And what that did to me was it made me think back on the very first day that we began shooting the first season of Star Trek. And that was in the year 2000. I've switched to the 21st century already. It was 1966. Most of you weren't born yet then. We all gathered, and in fact, Star Trek was not a Paramount production. It was a Desilu production, as you all know. And Desilu has a history too. There is a studio on the corner of Melrose and Gower that used to originally be called the RKO Radio Pictures. That was way back in the 30s. And it was founded by a good Hollywood businessmen that were bought out by Howard Hughes. How many of you remember that name? Howard Hughes. Yeah, he was a great playboy, but also fantastic. He was aerospace Elon Musk of that day. He was a visionary, and he built airplanes out of plywood and actually flew them. And he bought RKO Radio Pictures, and he founded a very buxom, beautiful young actress The studio was not very successful at that time when he bought it. So he bought it for a song, a very low price. He's a good businessman. He knows how to buy low and then sell high. He bought low, and then he hired this actress named Jane Russell. Some of the older people might remember who she is. She was very buxom lady. And he put her in a scandalous movie at that time called The Outlaw. And they had, they publicized the fact that she had real, her blouse was way down here, and made that into a great big smashing hit. And the value of the studio skyrocketed. And then he sold it to some Midwestern businessmen, RKO Radio Pictures. And they didn't know how to run a studio, and they ran it down. And it was, again, available dirt cheap. And a couple, a comedian and her Cuban bongo drum-playing husband, you know who they are, they got a television series called I Love Lucy and made a lot of money. Lucy Dad's here. And they became very wealthy, and so they bought the studio, RKO Radio Pictures, for, again, a song, and they built it up. And one of the reasons why, and they named it Desi for Desi Arnaz and Lucille Ball, Desi from Desi, Desi Arnaz, and Lou from Lucy, and called it Desi Studios. And they first were the producers of Star Trek. And Star Trek became a series. We found our lives. And we owe the beginning of Star Trek to the risk-taking of Lucy and Desi. And the studio head at that time, Herb Solo. And so we became, we filmed the pilot show and sold. And in February of 1966, we all gathered in a conference room at Desi Studios, the entire cast, and Gene Roddenberry, the creator of Star Trek. And he introduced all of us, and he told us that he wanted to tell a science fiction story, but at the same time, he wanted to use science fiction as a metaphor or something even bigger. The Starship Enterprise, where the story took place, was supposed to be a metaphor for Starship Earth. And the strength of this starship, he kept repeating, was in the fact of its diversity. Its diversity coming together and working in concert as a team. That's what made the Starship Enterprise, and which stood for the Starship Earth, a strong, innovative, problem-solving team. And that was the beginning of the idea of infinite diversity and infinite combinations. We made it into an acronym, IDIC, IDIC. And so that's, I think, one of the secrets that made Star Trek a success. People related to that, and the fact that we have to have confidence in our ability to solve problems, to innovate, to invent, and then to be entrepreneurial with that. And Star Trek boldly went where no one had gone before. And with that, he started to introduce the entire cast. Here, we wanted depict infinite diversity in infinite combinations. And the captain of the starship will be a dynamic, heroic leader, James Tiberius Kirk. He was to represent North America, and he's going to be played by a Canadian. Bill Shatner from Montreal, Canada. Europe was to be represented by a Scottish engineer, and his name was Montgomery Scott, a crack engineer, very good at solving problems. Montgomery Scott, the Scotsman, was to be played by another Canadian. Jimmy Doohan from Vancouver, British Columbia. Jimmy was a wonderful guy. In fact, he was seated right next to me at that conference table. And I became very good friends with Dr. Earth, good humor, and he became my favorite drinking buddy. And during one of those sessions, he told me, "I've become famous playing a Scotsman, but I'm actually an Irish Canadian. I'm of Irish ancestry." However, he insisted, "I've drunk enough of the libation of Scotland to qualify playing a Scotsman." And he qualified. I witnessed it. He loved his Scotch. Africa was to be represented by a black woman, Nyota Uhura, and she was played by a beautiful African-American actress from, what's that place? Robbins, Illinois. She was also, I knew Nichelle from before. She was a good friend of mine. But Nichelle was not just an African-American. She had French blood in her. And she also had Cherokee blood in her. So she was a native, she had the Native American blood. So she was probably the most American of us all. There's that other side of this planet called Asia. And he was to represent, or the character was named Hikaru Sulu. And he was played by me from Los Angeles, California. And to really underscore diversity, we had a first officer, Spock. His first name, he told us, was unpronounceable by humanoids. So we just called him Spock. And he was not biracial. He was by species. His mother was a humanoid, a human woman, an Earth woman, and his father was from the planet Vulcan. He was two different species of life forms, played by Spock, and he was completely and thoroughly logical about everything. He had great strength, and he had muscular strength, but had great strength up here as well. And he was to be played by Leonard Nimoy from Boston, Massachusetts. It was a wonderful group of people, and Leonard too became a very good friend of mine. He was very much like Spock. He was very intellectual. He was well-read, and I enjoyed sitting side with him and talking current events, and we discovered that we were political kindred souls, and we found out that we were supporting the same politicians and same candidates for public office, same issues, and we worked on campaigns together. And so this was the infinite diversity and infinite combinations. But in the second season, Gene Roddenberry added another diversity. He added a character named Pavel Chekhov, who was proud of his Russian heritage. And if you remember that, or those of you that were around, back then, the 1960s was probably the coldest point in the Cold War. The Soviet Union and the West glaring at each other, threatening each other with mutual nuclear annihilation. And here was a character in the 23rd century that spoke with a Russian accent, was proud of his Russian heritage, and he symbolized the fact that even an unsolvable conflict that we had back then could be overcome eventually, and Russian could become a trusted member of the Starfleet. And so he was a very Gene Roddenberry was a very optimistic guy about the human future. If we have confidence in our ability to solve problems, to innovate, there's no reason why we could not solve this kind of problem of geopolitical tension and reach that point where we work together as a team. And I'd like to think that it was that kind of philosophy, having confidence in ourselves and working in concert with teams of people that have a history, different races, different cultures, different faiths, different backgrounds, all coming together, and to be able to see a common challenge from different angles, different perspectives, and come up with the best solution. And I'd like to think that's why Star Trek caught on with the people eventually. After we were canceled, you know, at the beginning of each episode, we announced that we were boldly going on a 5-year mission. Well, we had many adversaries during in every episode, Klingons, Romulans, Andorians, but we discovered that the most destructive adversary was the NBC programming executives. They cut us off after 3 seasons instead of 5. But we showed them, because when it went into syndication, into reruns, the syndicators put us on 5 nights a week, Monday to Friday. And that's when the audience discovered us and the ratings soared. And at one point, Paramount was thinking of reviving us as a television series. But another interesting fact of sci-fi history is that in 1977, Star Wars was released, and it exploded at the box office. It made tons of money, and that's when the ugly head of greed arose at the Paramount executive corridors. They wanted to have a piece of that kind of box office. And they said, we have a sci-fi piece on our own lot here. We're thinking of reviving it as a TV series. Let's revive it as a series of movies instead. Or at that time, they were thinking of a series. Let's make that into a movie. And so the decision was made, and Star Trek, the motion picture, was released in 1979, 10 years after it was canceled. And the rest is history. We're a series of major feature films, and there'll be another feature film coming out this summer. And it's the rebooted cast. And I'm going to look very young in that. I'm going to look like John Jones. Now, all of us are going to look a little different, but you know, I'm really amazed at Carl Urban's portrayal of McCoy. He really captured DeForest Kelly's every quality about his movement, his speech, rhythm, and pattern. And he's a New Zealander, I discovered. He's not even an American. And he's able to capture DeForest so completely. He's a wonderful actor. And a sweet guy. I met him at a couple of conventions. And he's very humble and very approachable. I found him to be an interesting guy. So that's the, in a capsule, the history of Star Trek up to this point. And it's all thanks to you that we have this point to gather together. And I see people here that are eager to participate in the discussion. Your comments, your opinions, and your criticisms. So I see a young yeoman in a blue uniform, science department. You're on.
What was your favorite episode of film?
My favorite episode from the movies, from the films. It's the best one of them all, and I think you'll agree. It's Star Trek VI, The Undiscovered Country. I think They chose the wrong subtitle for Star Trek VI. It should be Captain Sulu to the Rescue. I think we would agree, it's Sulu at all the pivotal moments of that movie. From the very beginning, the first scene, we see the bridge of a brand new ship, the Excelsior. Bigger than the Enterprise. More powerful than the Enterprise. And it's got a great new captain. Captain Sulu of the Excelsior. He's sitting there in the big chair, confidently drinking his cup of green tea. And then Praxis explodes, and all hell breaks loose, and the drama begins. And at the crucial point of the drama, when that aging captain of the Enterprise is caught out in space, and he's about to be blown away to smithereens by the Klingon captain, who should come to the rescue out of the darkened galaxy sky but Captain Sulu and the Excelsior? And he says, target that explosion and fire, and blast the Klingons to smithereens, thus saving the day for Captain Kirk. And the traditional classic ending of all Star Trek movies on the bridge of the Enterprise. This time, a grateful and humble Captain Kirk. And he looks up at that view screen and the giant image of Captain Sulu. And he gets up and essentially says, thank you for saving my ass. And Captain Sulu looks down at him and says, good to see you in action one more time, Captain. And he roars off. And there's an absolutely awestruck McCoy. And he says, my God, that's a big ship. But Scotty chimes in with a twinkle in his eyes. But not so big as a captain, I think. That's a Captain Sulu movie, isn't it? That's my favorite movie of all the Star Trek movies. You're on.
Obviously, I love Star Trek. But I lucked out and was in New York City for my birthday last year. I got to see you in Allegiance, which was so moving and so amazing. My question is, I am an educator, and I want to know, are there plans to make it so that I can actually show my students the amazing is Allegiance, other than just making them listen to the original cast recording over and over and over?
Well, the plan at this point is we're going to tour the West Coast. That's where the memory is, because we were shocked to find out in New York, during intermission, people were in the lobby saying, is this a true story? Did this actually happen? So many Americans don't know American history. This is an important chapter of American history. It happened more than 70 years ago, but it's very relevant to our times today, because in our presidential election, that same kind of hysteria and prejudice is rampant. These sweeping statements being made that all, the terrorists have been Muslims, but the millions and millions of Muslims that are in this world are not terrorists. They are Christians. Very famous and much admired, heroic Muslim died just two days ago, Muhammad Ali, an American Muslim, And yet this candidate makes that sweeping statement, all Muslims need to be banned from entry in the United States. He should know that, you know, a few years ago, I toured Arlington National Cemetery, where all the heroes who died for this country are buried. Their headstones have the symbol of their faith, mostly crosses. But when you walk amongst them, you'll see a few headstones that have the Muslim symbol there. Muslims have died for this country. They fought for this country and they died for this country. And Donald Trump should take that tour and reassess some of those crazy, wild statements and the statements that he makes. American citizens. My mother was born in Sacramento. My father was a San Franciscan. You know, I'm the third gen. I was born in Los Angeles. Many Japanese Americans were fighting for this country, and yet we were swept up by war hysteria and the fact that we looked like the people that bombed Pearl Harbor. And so, with no charges, no trial, that's the central pillar of our justice system. When you're arrested, you have the right to know why you're being arrested. And then you have the right to challenge that charge in the court of law. In our case, there were no charges. I was 5 years old, but I remember that morning. It was a terrifying morning. Two soldiers with bayonets on their rifle marched up our driveway, stomped at the porch, banged on the front door with their fists, and my father answered, and literally at gunpoint, we were ordered out of our homes here in America. No charges, no trial, just the fact that we look like the people that bombed Pearl Harbor. And it's being repeated now in our presidential election. People have to think hard. And for me, what's really scary is that all these people are supporting that man. That is the scary part of this. And so, I hope that more people will see that, see allegiance. On the West Coast, there is a memory of that. It wasn't just those of us who were taken away, but the people that saw us being taken away. And so, I know that we're going to have an audience that really understands on the West Coast. And those of you who missed it on Broadway, why not think of a vacation at Los Angeles or San Francisco or Seattle next year and take in allegiance while you're there? Thank you very much for asking about it.
Hello, Mr. Takei.
Hi.
I've always wondered if you prefer mayo or ranch and why.
Do I just get two choices at your restaurant? I like vinaigrette. In the Star Trek t-shirt.
It's in a lot of Star Trek episodes, they tackle a lot of social problems like racism. Did you ever approach Gene Roddenberry about making an episode about homophobia?
As a matter of fact, I did. You know, I spent most of my life closeted because I was passionate about my career. I loved acting, and I had a career going, and I wanted to protect that career as much as possible. Because when I was a teenager, there was a handsome, long, athletic movie star named Tad Hunter. Most of you might not know who he was. You're nodding. He was probably your heartthrob too, wasn't he? It was, and I saw every one of his movies. He starred in every other movie that came from Warner Brothers. And then a scandal sheet called Confidential, back then, exposed him as being gay, and his career failed. And that was an object lesson for me. So I was closeted throughout until 2005. But even when as a closeted man, you know, the issue of justice, not equality, but just justice for LGBT people, I thought was an important issue that Star Trek could take on, because we're addressing the Vietnam War, the Cold War, the Civil Rights Movement, all the movements that were tearing the country apart at that time. And Gene Roddenberry had thrown a party for us. And this was at night at his pool home. And most of the people were at the far end of the pool, poolside, because the bar was there. And Gene swam out by himself at the other end. And so I saw that he was in a private position. I swam out and kind of treaded water with him, and we chit-chatted. And I brought up the subject of LGBT issue. And I said, we deal with a lot of issues on Star Trek. And, but the one issue that we haven't addressed is the lesbian and gay issue on Star Trek. And what do you think about that? Don't you think that might be an interesting subject to use metaphorically? And he said, yes, I've always had that in mind, but I've been pushing the issues. I've been walking a very tight rope, and I have to be very careful about the issues I take on, because on the black-white issue, I really pushed it to the limits. In that episode in which Kirk kisses Uhura, a white man and a black woman kissing, that became a very controversial issue. And that also was our lowest rated episode, because stations in the South, Louisiana, Alabama, Georgia, the Carolinas, refused to air it. And so that was our ratings plummeted because of that interracial kiss. He said, I have to keep the show on the air in order to be able to discuss the issues that we are discussing. And he felt that to deal with the same-sex issues would cancel the show. He said, I have to be on the air in order to be addressing the issues that we are now. And I understood that, because I was closeted at that time. It was speaking very frankly, very truthfully about the social condition at that time. And that's why I'm so glad that we live in this day and age when, yes, we still have to struggle. We have North Carolina right now, where the battleground is the bathroom. You know, it's a ridiculous issue. And it's an issue that was created, manufactured by right-wing politicians. Because in California, since 2005, the Los Angeles Unified School District has had a policy of allowing people to go to the bathroom of their gender identity rather than their birth certificate identity. And we've had no problems. Today is 2016. I'm not too good with dates. 11 years, and we've had no problem. When the governor of North Carolina talks about, you know, we're going to have pedophiles in little girls' bathrooms, and the reporter asks him, okay, cite an incident where that happened. He starts stuttering and fumbling. He can't name an issue. He says, I'll look into it. It is a manufactured issue by right-wing politicians where there is no issue. And so we still have to fight that struggle. But now we live in a whole changed world where the Supreme Court of the United States has said that marriage equality is a rule of the land from coast to coast, from border to border. And so we are making progress, but we still have those backlashes that we still have to deal with. Thank you for being in so much. Optimistic about things. My grandmother was a real optimistic lady, and she also had a good sense of humor. She was always chortling. She thought her grandchildren always were silly, and she was, you know, chuckling all the time. She said, "I have a hobby. My favorite hobby is collecting birthdays." And she doesn't understand her friends who try to hide their birthdays or lie about their age. She says, "Birthdays are wonderful because the alternative I don't like." She had a wonderful attitude, and that attitude carried her to the point where she amassed a very good collection of birthdays, 104 of them. Be like my grandmother, and I have her genes going through me, so I have a leg up, I think, on that. And so, I drink green tea, which she was addicted to, and I try to be as humor, finding humor in life. She says life is a comedy, and I really think she's right. And so that's why I'm smiling and happy all the time. Yes, I get serious too. But that's also an important part of life. But it's important to see life as something that is going to take you to another place where you're going to be very happy.
Hi, George. I am one of your original fans.
Yes, you are.
You will not recall this conversation, doubtless, but this is the second time I've spoken to you. I spoke with you a little bit when I was 14 years old, 49 years ago at Western Con. I was feeling pretty shy because I'd never talked to a cute TV actor before. And I thought you were the cutest guy on the show. And looking at your early photos, I was right.
Have good taste.
I am sure your husband would agree. Okay, so I asked you about that fencing scene in the first series, and then the first season, and I asked you if you had any training as a fencer, and you said no. And if you had any coaching on set, and you said no. And if you even had a cork tip on your foil, you said no. So I congratulated you on your bravery, and we had a laugh.
Well, I think I told you that I did have a few quick lessons.
Oh, maybe so. I was so nervous talking to you, I don't remember half the conversation.
Well, let me remind you.
Okay.
You know, when I was a kid, I saw Errol Flynn in The Adventures of Robin. I think
and
I
so did I.
I was swept away by that. And I went home, my backyard became Sherwood Forest. My mother made me a Robin Hood costume. And Oh, I hadn't heard any other costumes. My maid Marian was the girl down the street, Martha Gonzalez, I remember her name. She was my maid Marian. And Friar Tuck is short and tucky, right? But I had a friend named Gary McGarry, who was skinny and tall and long. But my mother made the costume, so he was Friar Tuck. And so I was, let's pretend, Fencer, as a kid. And so about a month before we would shoot that, the writer of that particular script, John D. Black, happened to be on the set. He plugged himself down beside me, and he said, I'm developing this script where this virus infects us from the palm of our hand, and it breaks down our inhibitions, and we do whatever we want to do. And I was thinking of letting Sulu have a samurai sword and terrorize a ship. And I said, well, that's interesting, because I'm Japanese American. It's ethnically consistent. Samurais are Japanese.
Yeah.
And so that's ethnically consistent. But I said, when I was a kid, I didn't play samurai, but I played Robin Hood. And so don't you think it might be interesting, and this is sci-fi, to put a fencing foil in Zulu's hands? And he said, hey, that's a good idea. By the way, do you fence? I said, it's my favorite sport. That's that. I was looking through the yellow pages. Do you know what yellow pages are?
Yeah.
You young people, you really do study your history, don't you? I was looking through the yellow pages and found fencing lessons. And there was a studio on Sunset Boulevard, not too far from me, called Falcon Studios. And so I rang them up and arranged for, I think, 2 weeks worth of fencing lessons. And of all serendipitous things, the man I got for my instructor was a man in his late 60s, but he was a fantastic fencer, Mr. Faulkner. And he told me that he choreographed the fencing sequences in The Adventures of Robin Hood. And he doubled for Basil Rathbone when Errol Flynn had, had his close-ups. So it was Mr. Faulkner's back that I was looking at when I was absolutely transported by all the fencing then. And so he gave me 2 weeks worth of lessons. So that's what I had when I filmed that episode. And I think I told you that.
You might have, but I was in an altered state.
But now you know.
Now I know the real story.
And you have heard it repeated to you. And I was given that 5-minute sign, so maybe just 2 or 3 more of you.
We already had a question about allegiance, and you invited Donald Trump to go and see it, and he did not take you up on it. I was wondering if you had any stories about people who did come see it and who were touched by it. Maybe a little bit of hope for us?
Indeed. I think everyone who came were deeply affected by that. Certainly the ones who were, thank you very much, you saw it too. It's a story that affects, it's a very moving story, and the music is wonderful. And the thing about the music is it hits you so profoundly, more profoundly than just words, you know. Music has a way of penetrating your heart. And so many people were moved to tears, and they heard the sniffles and the sobs on stage as well. It's a story that is so significant to us today, and I think I'm safe in saying that I have not heard a single negative comment about the story itself and how moving it was for them. I hope it was for you too.
meeting you, Mr. George K., and I was wondering, how do you feel about John Chu playing your character in the new Star Trek rebooted universe?
Well, I've known John for a long time, even before he was considered to play Sulu, because I'm chairman of the board of counselors of the longest running, continuously operating a minority theater company in America. Not just Los Angeles, not just California, but it's the longest operating theater company in the United States, the East-West Players. And when John was still in his early teens, he was being cast in plays that we did at the East-West Players. And when, I'll tell you, there's an interesting story behind it. When the rebooted cast was first being assembled, I got a call from J.J. Abrams' office asking me to have breakfast with J.J. And I thought, how interesting. Because Leonard Nimoy, it was announced, was going to do a cameo in the very first rebooted movie. And now he wants to have breakfast with me. Very interesting. And so I was very eager to have that breakfast with him. I got there and I met J.J. for the first time. He's a fascinating, charming, interesting guy with lots of ideas. He's high energy. He's almost perfect with energy and ideas. And so we had a nice conversation beforehand. But I kept wondering, what is he going to get to cast, talking about casting me? But then I discovered that he said, I've been casting for Sulu. And I wanted to find a Japanese-American actor because you're Japanese-American. I'm Japanese-American. And he said he's seen many actors, but he's found another actor that he thinks would be very good in the role. And he's not Japanese-American. And what do I think about that? And that's when I realized he didn't know Gene Roddenberry's philosophy. Because when Gene created the character to represent Asia, he gave a lot of thought to it. And his big challenge was finding a name for this character. Because every Asian last name is nationally specific. Tanaka is Japanese, Wong is Chinese, Kim is Korean. And 20th century Asia was turbulent with warfare, colonization, and revolutions. And he didn't want to take sides by having a name that indicated one nation or the other. He wanted to find a name that suggested all of Asia working together. And he had a map of Asia pinned on his wall. And he was staring at it, and off the coast of the Philippines, he saw that there was a Sulu Sea, and he thought, the waters of the sea touch all shores. And so that's how he came up with the name Sulu. And I told that story to JJ. It's not important that the actor be Japanese-American, as long as he's Asian. And is the actor you're considering Asian-American? And he said, yes. And I said, may I ask who? And he said, John Cho. And I told him, he would be a very good choice to play my part. Thank you.
I was also on the fortunate ones to be able to see Allegiance on Broadway, so that was awesome fun. And I can attest that it was very touching because my friend and I were criers crying. Thing.
I am too. I cry at tearjerkers. And when I start going, Brad starts elbowing me. And so I kind of try to hold it in. But you know, when you hold it in, the emotion builds behind it, like water behind a dam. And inevitably, the dam breaks. And I break out And Brad starts edging away.
But is that the reason why I decided to make the musical instead of a straight play? Because it is a very heavy topic. And are you excited about your off-Broadway debut in like a week or two?
What?
Your off-Broadway, the White Rabbit, Red Rabbit?
Oh, yeah.
Next week or something?
Next week, I think. Or not next week, the week after that, on Monday. Yeah, so if you have to be in New York, come to the West Side Theater on Monday night. It's a one-night-only thing. It's an interesting project. It's a play being produced by a very fine, experienced producer. And his experiment is to have a number of actors like Nathan Lane, Whoopi Goldberg, Alan Cummings, to play. It's a one-man play, cold, with no rehearsals, without the actors ever having read the script, to just come in and do what we do with it, and share it with an audience. And Nathan Lane's done it already, Whoopi Goldberg's done it already, Alan Cummings, I think, does it after I've done it. But it's a little daunting because I can't tell you anything about it. I'm not supposed to know anything about it, other than that we know nothing about it. And I'll be doing that not next Monday, but the Monday after that in New York. So should you be in New York, you're welcome to see me fall flat on my face or be absolutely brilliant. Thank you all very much for